eggs were sixpence a dozen more, the butter was fourpence a pound more. And there was a third item. I reckon, well, I'm sure that my shopping is costing me at least £1 a week more now.
What do you think the Minister for Agriculture, Mr. Pryor, meant then when he said that food prices have gone down since the election?
Well, I'd like to know. I would love to know.
Have food prices gone down, do you think, since the election?
No, well, they can't for a year or so. I don't think anybody expects them to.
The butcher's told me that that meat prices have gone down. How have you found that?
I don't think so. I doubt it.
No. I brought two pork chops. They're going up sixpence since last week. Same thing I brought last week.
What about other food prices?
And the same.
I mean, how much is
it? I brought a tin of salmon this Sunday, 5 and 9 pence last week. Last week it was 5 and 6 pence, that's flipping corn up in a week.
What do you think the Minister for Agriculture meant then when he said that food prices were going down?
Nothing. He thought it was a lot of months.
I think he's just gaining time, that's all. Yeah. Just gaining time, he's talking rubbish.
Rubbish? Well, yes, up to a point. Because though the government claims quite correctly that average food prices did fall between June and September, and only by under 1%, mark you, nevertheless, of the 80 foods that form that average, 44 have actually gone up in price, and only 18 gone down. So you see, if you're clever enough, you can prove that prices are going down even though they're going up. On the broad front, of course, prices are going up. The rise in the cost of living index shows signs of accelerating. Manufactured goods are up some 7% since this time last year. Beer up recently, fares up, petrol up, which in turn, of course, sends other things up. Bread even up again, another penny on the loaf at the end of this month. But are those shoppers really so badly hit after all? Because, of course, wages are going up too. Dustmen and municipal workers' wages up 16.5%, dockers up 25%, miners up 12% and some want more. Electrical workers have got in a claim for another 28% more wages. Gas workers have in what's called a substantial claim. Railwaymen, 250,000 of them, have in a claim for around 25% more. Now, these claims are, of course, going to send prices up again, which will mean people putting in more wage claims, which is called inflation. Why inflation matters, if it really does, is one of the things we'll be discussing in a minute in a debate between Mr. Roy Jenkins, Labour's former Chancellor of the Exchequer, and Mr. Enoch Powell, one-time Conservative Financial Secretary to the Treasury. Mr. Powell, Mr. Jenkins, incomes policy, of course, will be one of the things we'll be talking about in a minute. But first of all, I wonder if each of you could say how serious you really think the present situation is. Mr. Jenkins.
I think we do face a serious inflationary situation. When for years in the past we talked about economic crisis in this country, we've almost always meant that we weren't paying our way abroad and we're going to get into a balance of payments crisis. There's no such crisis. That is secure. But prices are increasing fast. They began to increase fast earlier this year. The increase has accelerated since the election, both absolutely and in relation to other countries. I think the present rate of increase is very sharp, and I think there are two particularly serious features. One, that the present government and the present Prime Minister was elected to a very substantial extent on saying that he would act directly to reduce prices at a stroke, was the famous phrase. And on the contrary, all the actions they've taken have put up prices. Now, I think that's bad for democracy, that a government should turn around like a squirrel in a cage as soon as it's been elected, make no attempt to carry out its promises. I also think it is serious economically, because it is increasingly apparent the government has no policy to deal with inflation, and we could be approaching a really dangerous take-off point from this point of view.
Mr. Powell, would you agree that the situation is dangerous?
Well, without challenging the resounding rebuke just delivered by Satan to sin about what is said at elections and what happens afterwards, of course it's serious. Something like a 6% increase in prices over a year, if continued, is bound to be serious.
Dangerous?
Well, not dangerous in my opinion in the Weimar sense. After all, the German government willed that sort of inflation. They knew what they were doing and they did it deliberately. But still very serious. Serious externally, because however secure Jenkins's word, and at the moment it is secure, is the balance of payments. You can't go on inflating faster than other countries before you're in trouble on the balance of payments. But more fundamentally serious, because although, as you said just now, things get readjusted, the circle comes round, there's the tremendous friction, sense of injustice, and often real injustice, to people and classes of people, which is involved in following this thing round, in chasing it round. Let me put it this way, that if 6% inflation could happen overnight, without anybody realising it, everybody, in every respect, going up 6%, well, one might not worry so much. But people do still look to money to give them something to steer by. And inflation at this rate, if it goes on, removes that. Well, so I say serious.
Well, I think we can agree on two things. First, I think Lord Hailsham's history was remarkably bad. There was terrible inflation in the Weimar Republic in its earlier days, but it was, in fact, unemployment which killed democracy and brought Hitler in Germany, and not inflation. That was a long way behind. And secondly, that although I say and believe it to be the case that the balance of payment is secure for the moment, of course it can't remain secure if we get steadily less competitive with other countries. Mm. And one of the worries here is that we are at the moment getting less competitive, no question about that. And the other is that a rate of price increase of 6-7% at home is extremely inconvenient for everybody, but is also extremely unfair on a lot of people, because nobody moves up evenly, and there are a lot of people who can't keep pace with inflation of this sort, and whose whole purchasing power and way of life is damaged.
Well, now, on that, we both rebuke sin.
We both rebuke sin.
Can I ask you a very, I'm sure, simple and even heretical question? You say there are a lot of people, Mr. Powell has said there are a lot of people, of course, who are suffering from inflation, but the fact is that most people, the average worker, doesn't particularly suffer from inflation, does he? Because he puts in a wage increase. There's a time lag before the wage increase is in any case larger probably than the cost increase that follows. There's a time lag before the cost increase. He then puts in another wage increase, and he is in fact getting a larger share of the national wealth all the time.
I doubt that. He might be over a particular period. I certainly wouldn't make a point that there may be a certain vested interest on the part of the professional trade unionists in having something to do all the time which looks as though they were bringing home the bacon. But I simply do not believe that for the mass of workers it is a gratifying thing to have to go for a claim which their fellow citizens resent, and which often involves a strike every year or every other year. I really don't think we need Keynes sin anymore. I think we've got to look at how you banish sin.
Yeah, I agree with that. There are a number of things, and we shall get on to disagreement about remedies, but I think it's certainly important to appreciate that I don't think you shift the share of the national income going to wage earners by means of inflation.
No, not because of
inflation. And I think that even if workers themselves are for a time think they're doing well out of it, though this is partly an illusion of a short period of time, I'm not sure their wives do well out of it at all, because I think maybe the proportion of incomes going to wives when you have a very rapid movement both of prices and income may fall, and that wives get the worst end of the stick.
And in the end there is the sense of resentment of those who feel that they thought they'd got something real, and feel that they are cheated, because it turns out not to be real, or at least most of it not.
So we all want, we both want, no doubt Mr. Key too, a slower rate of price increase. Think this is an urgent problem, I do certainly, and the question is how we deal with it.
But Mr. Jenkins, I wonder if you, speaking for the Labour Party, as you must inevitably be doing, really ought to be agreeing with Mr. Powell on this, because
I'm preparing to disagree with him very substantially in a short time.
But doesn't one want, if one is a member of the Labour Party, a more equal redistribution of wealth?
Oh, most certainly, most certainly. But I do not believe the way to get this is through constant inflation. I'm far from convinced that it's even neutral from this point of view, but it's certainly not helpful.
But the standard
I think that a highly inflationary situation is probably most beneficial to those who own and own a lot of hard, real assets, and that people with small savings, people on fixed pensions, whether they be moderate or small in size, certainly people on old age pensions, quite often low wage earners do very badly indeed out of it.
Well, now, I wonder what you're going to disagree about. Can we get on to the whole question of how you deal with this and incomes policy? Now, Mr. Jenkins, you had a sort of incomes policy under the Labour government, but it seemed to peter out.
Well, we'd always said that we would go on with this until the end of 1969. I don't think one should underestimate how effective it was, because, in fact, in 68 and 69, which were the 2 years following devaluation, which inevitably tended to push up prices. Devaluation means that you pay more for your imports, and therefore this pushes up prices. In those 2 years, it's a rather remarkable fact that our rate of price increase, though quite heavy, around about 5% in each year, was in the two slightly less than the United States, which had had no devaluation, which had no such excuse. It's really since then that we've begun to move from a 4.8% basis, not good, but not as bad as the 7% basis we are moving towards at the present time, and also that we began to move in a position in which we were doing worse than other countries. And therefore, I don't think one should dismiss the effectiveness of an incomes policy. Now, why did we get rid of it? Well, it doesn't, if I may say so, he hasn't yet opened his mouth on this, but it doesn't.
I've been invited.
It doesn't. It does not lie in the mouth of Mr. Powell or any of the then opposition, now the present government party, to criticise our doing this, because they were always strongly and dogmatically opposed to our position on incomes policy. And I think the country probably didn't want to go on with an incomes policy. And I think part of the reason for this was that those 2 years of incomes policy had been years of slow increase in the standard of living, as they were bound to be if we were to push resources into the balance of payments and get the balance of payments right, which we did. I think that circumstances could have been rather easier in 1970, and that you could have combined a voluntary incomes policy with a more rapid rate of increase in the standard of living.
And yet
but governments are the servants of the people and not the masters of the people in a democratic society.
Well, Mr. Powell, as one of the masters now, do you think there should be an economic policy?
An incomes
policy.
Well, we really must elementarily define what we mean by an incomes policy. Since any economic policy affects incomes, one can misuse language by calling it an incomes policy. But in fact, an incomes policy has a pretty clear meaning over which we would probably agree. It's a means of combating inflation by acting directly upon specific movements of prices and wages. You either order or you influence the way in which this wage, that price, is adjusted. That's what an incomes policy means, as opposed to other methods which attempt to deal with the problem generally and not specifically case by case. Now, I say that the Labour government said that they had an incomes policy, and during the period that they said they had, well, it wasn't the whole of the period, they were always saying they had an incomes policy. Certainly during the period that Mr. Jenkins was Chancellor of the Exchequer, the balance of payments recovered from the red into the black, and certainly the rate of price increase was no faster than it had been under his predecessor. But that doesn't follow that the one is the cause of the other. And now I'd like to tell you what I think was the cause of what happened. I believe it had nothing whatever to do with the alleged incomes policy, which in my opinion was never real, because it was never defined. Nobody has ever yet succeeded in saying how you establish principles according to which one can say, well, that price increase is inflationary. Now, that one's all right. Yes, that can go through. This one can't. Whenever people get up to that point, whether it was under Selwyn Lloyd and Macmillan in 1962 or in 1968, they always jib at that point because, in my view, there isn't a way of doing it.
So are you saying there shouldn't be an incomes policy?
Well, I am saying that an incomes policy, as I have defined it, is perfectly impracticable and impossible because it is undefinable. And that what happened under Roy Jenkins's chancellorship was something quite different, which we ought to understand because it helps us to understand what's happening today. He inherited, give me another moment or two, he inherited from his predecessor an immense, it had gone over 2 years, increase both in the supply of money, if you like, a money demand. And he proceeded to deal with that. He dealt with it by what he did with the budget, with expenditure. He dealt with it by what he did with taxation, swingeing taxation. But at any rate, he wiped out this increase in money supply. He stopped the increase in money supply during the earlier part of his period as Chancellor of the Exchequer. Of course, we were still reaping during that time the consequences of the former increase, the additional money seeping through and working its way around. And of course, if you cut off the supply, the annoying thing about money is that it will work faster for a time, so that it defeats your efforts to deal with it by cutting off the rate of increase. But certainly, Jenkins, and this ought to be acknowledged, did decisively, whether you like the way he did it or not, he did decisively stop, for that period, the rate of increase in the money supply. And that was the main thing, in my view, which brought the balance of payments into the black. Now, this year, and I've finished for the moment when I've said this, this year it started again. This year, from the beginning of this year, or perhaps at the end of last year, there began again a massive increase in money supply, which is still going on, and which certainly is still producing its effects. It cannot but produce the effect of higher prices. So if we're looking for the cure, we've got to get the cause firm first. And I would have thought that he and I, at any rate to that extent, would probably agree on the cause.
Now we begin to disagree. It's perfectly true that I used the so-called monetary weapon when I was Chancellor. I used it more in the latter part of my period than the former part. I used it more in 69 than in 68. I used it not on its own, I used it to fortify other measures in the taxation field, and in my view in the incomes policy field, which I had taken. But used as a fortifying measure, I think that that it did help to be effective. But I never believed that it could be do the whole job. Nor do I believe that it is right, even as a piece of diagnosis, to say that inflation can be attributed, stems directly from an increase in the supply of money during 1970. The fact of the matter is that if one wants to look for fundamental causes, inflation has been a remarkable phenomenon spread throughout the whole of the developed world in the past year at a far greater rate than we've known at any time since the war. And this has come under governments pursuing different monetary policies and of very different political complexions. And that's why I thought it was partisan nonsense for the party of Mr. Powell. I'm not sure whether he himself said this during the election. He didn't often say what his party was saying, so he may well not have done so. But for the party of Mr. Powell to talk about inflation during the election as though it were purely a British phenomenon, a direct result of the policy of the Labour government, it was nothing of the sort, nor a direct result of any monetary policy, good or bad. But the main issue at the present time is how we deal with it. Now, I think you need a reasonable degree of monetary discipline. But I also think that
May I ask you what that means exactly, monetary discipline?
That you do not allow the money supply to increase too fast. That you pursue a roughly neutral monetary policy at the present time. That you don't stoke up inflation by means of pouring out money.
But isn't that what Mr. Powell was suggesting?
As I understood it, he says that the inflation is entirely due to the monetary policy you pursue, that it stems from monetary policy, and that it can be cured by policy.
I'll settle for your expression. Stoke it up.
I don't believe it stems from it, and I don't believe you can cure it.
But I'm perfectly prepared to agree that, as compared with the pre-war world, there are basic trends, very deep and worldwide, if you like, which tend to push governments into causing or permitting or conniving at inflation. And I'll agree that what we are really concerned with, and right at the beginning, Jenkins said he wanted a slower rate of increase of inflation. I won't argue about that. But he says, too, you stoke this up by the government behaving in a way which increases the money supply, or by permitting it to increase. And that is why taxation came into his explanation of what he did, because as government expenditure was rising quite rapidly, not so rapidly as a little earlier.
It was rising in 68 and
Well, it was rising
69 in particular.
2 or 3% a year, probably in real terms.
Less than 69.
Well, it was rising. And you financed that with increase in taxation because you knew very well that if you didn't, that was going to turn itself into additional money and an acceleration of money. So on this, basically, however we put the emphasis, we are agreed. And that is why, for the Conservative government to say, we are, as a matter of principle, over 5 years, going to get the share of government in the activities of the economy down. We are going to cut expenditure as a means to cutting taxation, but we are going to get the government out of it, pull it back, is relevant to inflation. That is why it is right for Mr. Heath to say that it is essentially a creative, I think he would have done better perhaps to say an effective approach.
But isn't this surely going to lead in the end to what everyone in this country dreads, all the working forces of this country, unemployment? Because you're going to withdraw the money supply, withdraw investment.
Well, that will be the case if you assert, which I don't believe, that there is, and some do, that for a certain level of inflation or stability there corresponds a given level of unemployment, then this is fatalism, and whichever way you get the demand down, you're going to have that unemployment. I don't believe that.
Now, this is where I disagree with Mr. Powell. I think his party's hand is rather feebler, his party's view is rather feebler, but he, who always carries things to their logical conclusion, whether this be good or bad, would like to use the monetary weapon to strangle inflation. I think if you try and rely on the monetary weapon alone, one, it'll break in our hand. Two, if it didn't break in our hand, almost any democratic government would lose its nerve, as the Nixon administration has in America. And three, if it didn't lose its nerve and tried to carry it through, be in no doubt what trying to do this by the monetary weapon alone would mean. It would mean interest rates going much higher, which means mortgages costing more, which means businessmen finding credit more difficult to get and paying still more for it. It would mean a great number of bankruptcies, and in my view, it would mean unemployment on a scale we have not remotely known since the war.
So these
are tremendous penalties, and I believe it is far better to seek a solution to inflation, which you use a number of weapons, in moderation. You use the monetary weapon, but in great moderation. You don't use it in a way to strangle economic activity. And this means you must be prepared to supplement it by direct intervention in the economy in varying ways.
Now, in what ways? Exactly what would you do, for instance, if you were Chancellor now?
Well, I would certainly not have got rid of the Prices and Incomes Board, which Mr. Powell attacked earlier on, saying that this all produces distortions. I think it did a very good job. I don't think it did a perfect job. I think you rarely do perfect jobs, but a very worthwhile job. I think I would certainly not have done the mini-budget, which is irrelevant to the problem of inflation. This is the real criticism of the government's policies. They are all irrelevant to inflation, and insofar as they have any relevance, they exacerbate it, because they make people, the wage-earning people, the great mass of the wage-earning people, worse off. And so they make them more anxious to put in claims. I would pursue a much fairer budgetary, social service, fiscal policy. And on that basis, had we won the election, without having done that, I would certainly have spoken to the trade unions and endeavoured to get a new deal with them on which we both faced up to our responsibilities and realised one could not push incomes up without limits.
Of course, you'd have them on your side, which Mr. Powell's party perhaps hasn't. Mr. Powell, very briefly, can you say what advice you would give to Mr. Heath now to do about inflation?
To do what we've already set out to do, and that is to control money, which is the essence of inflation, and the escape from control of which is the cause of inflation being stoked up. And can I very briefly, very crudely, deal with the proposition that it causes unemployment?
And I'm afraid that'll have to be in the next programme, but thank you very much indeed, both of you, Mr. Jenkins, Mr. Powell, thank you.